I think we can slowly start now. Good evening. My name is Gerry Eriksen, and I am sitting in the board of IDAE, which are hosting this seminar this evening. And I have to welcome all the participants here for this meeting in English, but a special welcome, of course, to Niels Gregersen, which are going to give the talk this evening. Niels is an associate professor from the Institute of Photonics at ETU, and he's also the winner of the Electronic Award 2020 from IDA this year. So, that's one of the reasons for Niels is going to give this talk this evening here. The talk will be in English, and also so if there are any questions, we will prefer that will be in English. Otherwise, if there are questions in Danish, I will try to translate them. Regarding questions, there is a special Q&A channel here. So please write your questions and I will forward them to Niels during the seminar. And then of course, Niels can ask them. The chat channel should be more used if there are more general things about this event, some sound problems maybe, or whatever it could be. But technical question related to the talk, please use the Q&A function and we will forward the questions to Niels. I think that was all. Also, I should mention that your audio and your video is muted from the beginning here. So, but that's like what we used to do in these seminars here. Otherwise, I think I will give not the floor, but the screen to Niels Gregersen. Thank you very much for coming this evening, Niels. And yeah, the screen is yours.
Thank you very much, Gerd. So first of all, I'd like to thank Elektrofonden and IDA for inviting me to give this seminar. So of course, we were all supposed to meet at Kalvebod Brygge and have a nice dinner together and a nice glass of red wine. So unfortunately, for reasons that you all know, this could not take place. But of course, an advantage of such an online seminar is that people who could not otherwise join can participate in the seminar. I understand we even have a participant from Greenland with us. Anyway, so I will talk about quantum light sources. So I guess we are all familiar with light sources such as lasers and LEDs. So what is the quantum part here? What does that mean? Well, quantum mechanics tells us that light cannot be divided into arbitrarily small units. There's a smallest unit, which we refer to as the photon. And this is a strange quantum mechanical object, which has the ability that it can be in my left hand, or it can be in my right hand, or it can be in both of my hands at the same time. So for the experts, so the title is Quantum Light Sources, but I'll restrict myself to discussing deterministic quantum dot-based single photon sources, and I'll explain in detail what that is in the following. So to start with, we can simply think of the quantum light source or the single photon source as a photon gun. When we press the trigger, exactly one photon, one happy face is emitted into some kind of optical aperture. So first, a few words about myself. So I am a master from the University of Copenhagen, but I actually chose to do my master's project at DTU for Photonik together with Dan Birkedal. I then spent and a year and a half in industry, after which I returned to DTU to perform my PhD studies. And then I've been in DTU ever since. So today I'm an associate professor. I teach two courses, one on quantum optics together with Alexander Hook and another on nano optics. And then I'm coordinating two mandatory project courses. So this is my current team. So we have Being, who is a guest PhD student, and Marriage, who is a shared DTU student, also with Electro, who's been with me for some time. So recently, Eugene and Martin joined me, and also Luca as an assistant professor. And I am hiring a new postdoc and a new PhD student to work on fabrication. So the application deadline is today. So if you, after this talk, should be inspired or would want to apply, then you still have several hours to prepare your application. So this is an outline of my presentation tonight. So when you ask a quantum physicist what he or she does for a living, then things will unavoidably become very technical. So instead of going straight for a discussion of how you optimize the efficiency of a single photon source from 10 to 50 to 90 to 99%, I have chosen to start with a more general introduction to the overall frame of quantum information technology, where I'll try to discuss what does it mean when we say that the photon can be in my left hand, or it can be in my right hand, or it can be in both of my hands at the same time. What does this actually mean? So this is not my work, but I think this will be a good introduction to get an idea of what this is all about. Then I will discuss what are single photon sources, what are the figures of merit, what is a good single photon source. And then I will discuss the main challenges that we have in this area related to collection efficiency and indistinguishability of the emitted photons. And at this stage, things will become more technical when we discuss major design strategies. And if my friends and family at this stage should choose to switch from Zoom to Netflix, then all is forgiven. So I'll talk about the micropillar, and if time allows, also the photonic nanowire geometry. And then I will give an outlook about where we are today. But let's start with the introduction. And I should also say that this is the first time I'm giving an after-dinner presentation, so I don't know exactly how we are with regards to timing. I probably have way too much material. But nevertheless, I think if you have questions, please jump in. I think it's more important that we have a good discussion, that I cover every part of the material. Yes. So within quantum information technologies, then the central unit is the quantum bit or the qubit, and it can be written as a superposition of two classical states, the classical zero and the on and one. So in a classical computer, the unit is a bit, and here alpha and beta would take values of either zero and one, such that the bit would either be in the zero and the one state. However, within quantum information, alpha and beta can take any values within or between zero and one. And we thus have that the qubit can be in an infinite number of states. So similar to the bit, the qubit is, and you can see, an abstract quantity which has to be encoded on something such as a magnetic spin or an electrical current. So encoding a quantum bit on a single photon allows for a series of advantages. So first of all, the photon is a flying qubit, and it's very compatible with the communication applications. It is a robust qubit, and the information then tends to stay in the photon once it has been encoded, and we can manipulate the photon with off-the-shelf devices. And finally, unlike solid-state qubits, if we have a good single photon source, then we can generate as many photons or qubits as we want to. So there are many technologies that employ single photons. So one technology which is available today is quantum key distribution or quantum cryptography. So here Alice and Bob are interested in talking to each other without having an eavesdropper Eve listen in on the communication. And this can be done by encoding their bitstream on single photons. And this can be done in such a way that undetected eavesdropping is impossible according to the laws of quantum mechanics. There's no guarantee against breach of service, so Eve can still simply cut the cable, but she cannot listen in on the communication without a red lamp lighting up on the communication equipment with Alice and Bob. So this is a commercially available technology. However, within quantum information, the holy grail is probably the quantum computer. So let us now consider an optimization problem, which is illustrated here, where we have some arbitrary mathematical function as function of two parameters, P1 and P2. And our task is now to maximize this function as function of P1 and P2. So find the parameters P1 and P2 for which we have a peak here. So the way this would be done roughly on a classical computer is illustrated using this small script. So you would vary P1 and P2 between in a certain range, and then you would evaluate this function, I guess, a total of 2,500 times, and then you would say your solution is the one where the function is maximum. So in a quantum computer, this takes place in a little bit different way. So again, you have an input, which we label here P, but this can be prepared in such a way that P contains all possible values of P1 and P2 at the same time. And thus you only need to perform a single calculation because your input state is in all possible, so all 2,500 input states at the same time. And then you would say, okay, again, the solution is the maximum value of this output. And now I put a question mark here because I'll actually come back to that because there's a subtlety here. So now we have our qubit and it's encoded in, for example, the polarization of a single photon. And we say that the qubit can be in the zero on the one state or in an arbitrary superposition of the two. And thus the photon can be in two polarizations as one, so in two places at once. And what is it we actually mean by that? I'm not sure I can give you a completely satisfying response to this, but I can at least explain to you what it is we mean. So let's consider a card game where we have three cards and we want to find this ace of spades. And now I shuffle the cards and you don't know where the ace is and we want to find it. So if we simply try a single time to guess where the ace is, then you have no clue about where it is, of course. And if you pick one of the cards, then you will most likely not find it, and we cannot predict the outcome. However, if we repeat this card game trick a million times, then we actually know with absolute certainty what the outcome is going to be. Then one third it's going to be over here, one third of the time it's going to be here, and one third of the time it is going to be here. So this is statistics and probability theory. So now I should also be able to convince you that, okay, if we have a photon and it can be in either of these three boxes, again, the scenario will be the same, that, okay, once we close the boxes and we don't know where it is, then the probability of it being here will be one third, of being here one third, and over here will be one third. Now we introduce the so-called wave function psi. So it's a complex scalar function, but otherwise nobody really knows what this wave function is. But what we do know is its interpretation. So the wave function describes the probability distribution of finding, for example, our photon, which is given by the absolute square of the wave function. So in the scenario we saw before, then the probability of finding the photon in box A is one third, and thus the absolute square of the wave function would be one third. And this description allows for the photon to be in all three boxes at once. And what is it we mean by that? And this I will try to explain in the following few slides. So to understand this, we should consider the phenomenon of interference. So when we are dealing with complex functions, such as these wave functions, then we can add them together. And due to the different phases of these wave functions, then we will obtain constructive and destructive interference. I should say that this is a very rough description here, so I've skipped the normalization factors, and I guess there should also be a 1 divided by R dependence here, but let's forget about that. Instead, let's look at this figure over here, which describes the propagation of this wave functions for the particle being in the position A and the particle being in the position B. So this figure shows spherical waves extending from this A and B position, and we observe constructive and destructive interference in terms of these maxima and in white and minima in blue, which correspond to either having zero chance or no, very little chance of detecting the particle, or in the case of constructive interference, having a large probability of detecting the particle at this position. So especially for people working with Maxwell's equations and Maxwell's equations and classical wave propagation, this is probably completely acceptable. But even if you're not familiar with complex numbers and Maxwell's equations, you can still relate to this scenario. So if you go into the forest, to a lake, and you throw a rock into the lake, then you will see the emergence of these circular waves. And if you throw not one, but two rocks into the lake at the same time, you will see two emerging circular waves, which will display amplifications and attenuations of the wavefronts in certain positions. And this is actually exactly the same phenomenon that we are dealing with. Except, of course, that we are considering not water, but quantized particles such as photons, or as illustrated in this slide, an experiment with electrons, which are, of course, also quantized particles. So what is shown in this slide is the famous double slit experiment where you have an electron gun up here, which emits electrons towards a screen, which contains, in this case, a single slit. So electrons passing through this slit, they are diffracted a little bit by the slit, and then they are detected on this observation screen. So if you detect a single electron, it's simply one click on the screen. But if you repeat this experiment a million times, then you obtain this pattern here reflecting the diffraction pattern of the electron. And now we can implement a screen with two slits, and now the scenario is exactly the one that we had before. So electrons can originate from slit A or slit B, and the wave function describing the propagation of the photons will interfere with each other, leading to constructive and destructive interference, which can be observed as this modulation here of the pattern that we saw for the single slit. So this interference pattern, which is observed, this interference phenomenon that we see here, it relies critically on us not knowing whether the electron has passed through slit A or slit B, such that we can obtain constructive or destructive interference between these two wave functions. So I try to illustrate this using these two cards, where we don't know if the electron passed through slit A or slit B. So on the other hand, let's say that we somehow can measure whether or not the electron passed through slit A. So we now know that the ACE is on the left side. This will have the consequence that the interference pattern that we saw before is gone. And this is, technically speaking, because now there's zero chance of the photon being in slit B, so psi B is gone, and we no longer have the interference between the two wave functions. So in this way, we will say that the fact that we don't know whether the electron has passed through slit A or slit B can be described as the electron passing through both slits at the same time. Now, let's get back to our optimization problem from before. So, the quantum computer, it can prepare an input state which is in a superposition of all these 2,500 input states. And this superposition, in terms of what we just saw, basically means that we have a quantized particle which can be in either of 2,500 different states at the same time, and then we perform our simple operation and obtain our result. And now the question is, can we now simply evaluate the solution in the same way as we did for the classical computer? This would of course be incredibly cool, because then we would have that the quantum computer would be 2,500 times more fast than our classical computer. However, unfortunately, it is not so straightforward. So if you put a classical algorithm such as the one that we have here, where you're simply evaluating some function as function of some input variables, then when we try to actually perform a measurement of this function, then within quantum mechanics, we perform what is referred to as a projective measurement, which leads to a collapse of the wave function for all other states than the one that we are observing. So it means that we may have the result for a single set of values of P1 and P2, but during this measurement, we have lost information about all other states. So this means that we cannot simply use our quantum computer to solve the same problems as the classical computer. Then there will be no advantage of the quantum computer. Instead, we somehow have to feed the quantum computer with algorithms, so programs, which exploit these interference phenomena that we can have between the wave functions that we just saw before. So an example of such a quantum algorithm taking advantage of these interference phenomena that we can have is this so-called Shor's algorithm. Now, it turns out that within classical encryption that we use to encode information between our home computer and our net or our bank, then one of the algorithms which is used is this RSA algorithm, where the security relies on the difficulty of factorizing large numbers into prime values. Now, Shor's algorithm is capable of doing exactly that, so efficiently factorizing large numbers, and we're talking numbers of the order of 10 to the power of 300 or something like that, so huge numbers. So it's capable of very efficiently factorizing large numbers into their primes. So it relies on these interference phenomena that we just discussed, and thus requires a quantum computer. So the algorithm is illustrated here, and I now have 10 slides describing the algorithm. We will not go through them. I simply included them in the presentation because I had them from another presentation. And I know that Gerd and Ida will share these slides. So for those of you who would like to understand in detail how Shor's algorithm takes advantage of this constructive interference, then please have a look at my slides. But now I will skip a little bit ahead. So this is discrete mathematics. And I will simply go to the summary of this first part. So where we have seen that we can have a photon which can be in either of in this case three boxes. So, and by this we mean that the probability, if we repeat the experiment a million times, will be one third, one third, and one third. So, this being in the same on three boxes at the same time relies critically on our not knowing where the photon is. So if we cheat and we look into the box, then we have this collapse of the wave function and all of these interference phenomena, which are really what's making up the strength of the quantum computer, they disappear. On the other hand, if we do not look, if we have no knowledge about where the photon is, then we can say that, okay, the photon is in all three boxes at the same time. And what we mean by that is that we have these interference phenomena, which can be exploited in quantum algorithms, for example, to factorize very efficiently these very large integers. As you can understand in detail if you download the slides and go through this algorithm. And in the interest of time, I will skip that. So now to make the connection to my own work, then this slide illustrates an optical implementation of Shor's algorithm. So the experiment takes place by sending single photons, so these red circles, into a linear circuit. The photons interfere with each other, and then they are detected at the other end, in the other end by single photon detectors, which are not shown here. So in this science paper, it is revealed that the number of 15 is the product and of 3 and 5. And since this science paper some 10 years ago, there has not really been demonstrations of Shor's algorithms for larger numbers, not at least within optical implementations. And what is the problem? Well, the problem is that these input photons that we have here, which are encoding our qubits, the generation probability, so the generation efficiency of these single photons in this experiment was extremely low. So it took a lot of time in the experiment to wait until actually all four photons were successfully generated. So if you want to factorize larger numbers, then you need more qubits. Then you need more photons. And then it's not, this is not possible if you have very inefficient single photon sources or very inefficient generation of single photons. So if we want to be able to factorize larger numbers, then here for Shor's algorithm, then we need good sources of single photons. And that brings me to the second part of the presentation, where I will discuss the characteristics of single photon sources. So Gerd, maybe we can take some questions now, if there's something to this this first part.
Yes, nobody have asked any questions. Oh, there's one coming here, sorry. A question here from Natasha asking, how do we make sure that the photons arrive?
Arrive or arrive at the same time?
I guess, how to make sure that they arrive at all? Like no data loss.
Yes, maybe we can get back to this when I describe the properties of single photon sources, because of course deterministic emission and efficiency, meaning that we are 100% sure that the photons have been generated, is of course key properties of single photon sources. So perhaps I would like to get back to this question in just a while. Is that okay?
I assume it is, yes.
Okay. 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 But thank you for this. But let's continue, and then I will cover some of these things. Okay. So we need single photon sources for our optical quantum computer, for example, for factorizing large numbers, but also for other applications, as I will get back to later. Yes. So just to make it crystal clear, so what is a single photon source? Well, we can think of it as a single photon gun. When we press the trigger, exactly one happy phase is emitted into this aperture. So the ideal single photon source should combine various aspects, which I will discuss in detail in the following three slides. So the first thing, and this is related to the question, is that the single photon source should be deterministic. So that means that every time we press the trigger, exactly one photon is emitted. And I'll show an example of a source which is not deterministic in just a while. And then, of course, the most basic property of the single photon source is that it should only emit one photon at a time. So not two or three or zero, but one photon at a time. And now things get a little bit technical. So the photon should be quantum mechanically indistinguishable. I'll get back to that in a little while. And they should be detected with near unity efficiency. So basically meaning that we send one photon into our output channel, into our optical fiber or our waveguide every time, where we define the efficiency as the number of photons detected in the fiber or the waveguide per trigger. And this leads us to the first very important figure of merit, which is fairly easily to understand. So that is the efficiency of a single photon source, which is, as mentioned, a number between zero and one. So if it's zero, then we obtain no photons. But if it's one, then we obtain one photon every time we press the trigger. And this is what we want. So if we make a multi-photon interference experiment in our optical quantum computer, and half of the photons are not there, then the computation will fail. So it's absolutely necessary to have an efficiency close to unity. The second very important aspect of the single photon source is that it should emit single photons. So here is illustrated so-called Hanbury, Brown and Twiss experiment, where we send in an optical pulse containing ideally a single photon onto a beam splitter which either transmits or reflects light towards two detectors, where we implement a time delay which is adjusted such that at zero time delay, the two pulses arrive at the detectors at the same time. So if we have more than one photon in our pulse, then some photons can be transmitted and others can be reflected, and we can have simultaneous detection events in both of our detectors at the same time. However, if our input pulse contains only a single photon, then this photon can either be transmitted or it can be reflected, but we will only have a click in this detector or in this one, but we will not have simultaneous detection events in the two detectors. So in order to measure the single photon purity, then we can measure coincidence counts in these two detectors as function of time delay. And at zero time delay, then we should ideally measure zero counts reflecting this scenario that the pulse has either been transmitted or reflected, but that we do not have multiple photons which reach the detectors at the same time. And thus we can define a second figure of merit, which is the purity described by this so-called autocorrelation function G2 evaluated at tau equals zero. I'll not talk so much about the purity in the following. I will simply assume that the purity is perfect. So I'm a theoretician. So I leave this concern about the purity of the photons to the experimentalists. And then there's a third figure of merit, which is the so-called quantum mechanical indistinguishability of the emitted photons. So this is a little bit technical, but for almost all applications in quantum information technology, we require that our photons are completely indistinguishable, such that they are identical in all aspects, such they have the same wavelength, they have the same polarization, they have the same phase, they have the same mode profile, the same everything, such that we cannot discern the difference or observe a difference between two photons. Now, we can test this indistinguishability using an experiment which is actually similar to the one we just saw, where we have a beam splitter and we send in single, hopefully indistinguishable photons on each side of the beam splitter. And now if the photons are perfectly indistinguishable, then they always leave the beam splitter together. This is somewhat technical, but this can be understood from a quantum optical consideration of the various output configurations. So it turns out that the configurations where we have that both photons are reflected and both photons are transmitted interfere destructively with each other, such that these two are the only possible outcomes. However, this so-called Hong-O-Mandel effect, where the photons leave together, relies critically on the photons being indistinguishable. So if we somehow change one of the photons using, for example, this electro-optical modulator to change the energy, then this effect no longer applies and the photons can leave the beam splitter separately. So again, by measuring coincidence counts, then we can measure the indistinguishability of the emitted photons, which again is a number between 0 and 1, where we want the indistinguishability to be as close to 1 as possible. Yes. Now, I mentioned that the single photon generation should be deterministic, and I promised you an example of a way to produce single photons which is not deterministic. and that is the attenuated laser. So here what we do is we take a standard laser pulse, and then we let it propagate through an absorbing material, and then we attenuate the laser pulse down to the single photon level. So this is a way of producing single photons. The advantage of this process is that it's extremely simple. You can simply buy a standard laser diode, and then you take an absorbing material, and then you have single photons. The weakness of this process, procedure, is that it's not a deterministic process. So the attenuation is probabilistic. So what we want is to have this ideal train of single photons illustrated here. But due to the probabilistic nature of this attenuation process, then we sometimes obtain one photon, but sometimes we obtain two photons, and sometimes we obtain zero photons. So we have this Poisson distribution of the photons. And this is not what we want. So this will lower the efficiency when we have zero photons. And the fact that we sometimes obtain two photons can present a security risk for example, the quantum cryptography application that we saw previously. So instead, as alternative, my favorite object for generating single photons is the semiconductor quantum dot illustrated in this scanning electron micrograph. So where quantum dot is an island of semiconductor material, in this case indium arsenide, surrounded by a host material, in this case gallium arsenide. And the quantum dot is localized in all three directions. And this 3D confinement leads to, and I should say also that the surrounding material should have a higher band gap than the indium arsenide quantum dot. So in that case, we obtain, similar to what we have in atoms, discrete energy levels of the electrons in the quantum dot. And then similar to what we have in atoms, then we can obtain emission of single photons by recombination of electrons with holes. So the process is illustrated over here. So we can have, using electrical or optical excitation, we can generate excited states. And as these decay in a radiative cascade, we can, using spectral filtering of one of these lines, we can obtain emission of single photons. So this quantum dot allows for fast and efficient emission of single photons. And this is what we use for the single photon source designs in the following. So I will now continue with the main challenges in quantum dot-based single photon sources. And again, of course, if there's a question, Gert, then we can take it now.
And so far, no questions.
Okay, great. So we'll continue and take a few more slides, and then we'll make a small brainstorming. I'll ask you, the audience, a question, and then we can combine this with a short break. So anyway, first of all, yeah, so these semiconductor quantum dots are excellent emitters of single photons, and they have an internal quantum efficiency of almost unity. However, the big challenge in single photon source engineering is what happens to the photons after they have been emitted. For a quantum dot in a bulk material, as illustrated here, the symmetry of the system leads to light emission in all directions. The efficiency is only a few percent, and almost all of the light is lost. And some people have felt that the term zero photon source was more appropriate. So we see that if we want to engineer a near unity efficiency single photon source, we have to control the light emission. And this can be done by placing our quantum dot into some kind of microstructure, which directs all of the emitted photons towards the collection optics. So this basically comes down to constructing an optical antenna with the purpose of increasing the efficiency towards towards Unity. And for the electrical engineers out here, then I should add that when we model this spontaneous emission from quantum dots, then this can be done in a completely classical way because of an equivalence principle. So basically, we can implement a classical dipole at the position of our quantum dot, and then we can simulate this using COMSOL or whatever software we are using. Simply by solving Maxwell's equations for a classical dipole. Okay, so we are discussing how to improve the efficiency and the directivity, you can say, of optical antennas. So we are basically solving an antenna problem. And now I'd like to ask a question for the audience, and then we'll take a few minutes with a break to think about this question. And the question is that, of course, antenna engineering is nothing new. So we have been engineering antennas operating in the radio frequency regime for some 50, 60 years. So I'm thinking that I should replace this picture of this metal Yagyuda antenna with one of a smartphone for the younger generation. But I at least am old enough to remember these metal antennas that we all had on our rooftops. And now the question I would like to ask is, if we have decades of experience with radio frequency antennas, why don't we simply reuse these antenna concepts in the optical domain? And I've given two hints here, and one is that the thermal energy at room temperature is around 6 terahertz, and the other one is that the extinction coefficient of most metals at optical wavelengths is very small, so it's a little bit better for silver than it is for gold, and even better for aluminum, but still light penetrates significantly into metals at the optical wavelengths. Okay, and with this, I propose we take a few minutes so we can take a glass of wine or whatever we want to do, and then we can continue from there.
Okay, Emil, should we say 3 or 5 minutes? What is your idea?
3 minutes, perhaps.
3 minutes. Okay. We'll be back in 3 minutes.
Yes. Their hands, then let's give them the opportunity. But
if they raise the hand, then Karina can unmute them, and then they can ask the question directly. So you can have a discussion with them, and then when the question are finished, then the next one.
Well, yes. So I'll repeat the question now, and if there's someone who has who would like to answer, then or has an idea, then we can take it, and otherwise I'll continue. Yeah. So the question is, if we can simply take these concepts that we have developed in the radio frequency. Within the radio frequency antenna engineering field and carry them over to optical antennas. And I've given two hints to the answer, namely one is that at 300 at room temperature, then the thermal energy is 6 terahertz, and that the penetration of light into metals at optical wavelengths is quite significant. Is anyone raising their hands?
Please, there is a Q&A here. Sorry, no.
Okay, then I'll simply explain this. Okay, So the issue with the radio frequency concepts is that the energy separation of the single photon state from the vacuum state should be large compared to the thermal energy in order to avoid accidental thermal excitation of the single photon state, which would appear as noise in our optical quantum calculation. So this means that we have to operate at energies or frequencies significantly larger than 6 terahertz. So then we are moving into the optical or the near infrared regime, which is around 500 terahertz. So we cannot operate at radio frequencies. This is the reason why we have to work at optical frequencies. And then the problem is that all of these antenna designs, they rely on metals being perfect conductors, which is true at the radio frequency regime, but it's definitely not true for optical frequencies where light penetrates significantly into metals, leading to significant losses. And losses kill our efficiency. While I'm not ruling out that some kind of metal optical antenna concept could be implemented, then so far design concepts based on metals are simply so lossy that our efficiency drops to the ground. So we basically have to abandon metals in our single photon source design, which basically means reinventing our antenna concepts from scratch. Yes. Okay, so in our description of single photon sources, then we typically introduce two parameters. So one is the spontaneous emission beta factor, which is given here, which is the spontaneous emission from our quantum dot into our optical mode of interest over the total spontaneous emission rate. So our mode, modes are concepts from most branches of physics. So we talk about vibrational modes or optical modes, which represent a specific solution to our differential equation and describe a spatial profile of our solution. In this case, the fundamental mode of a waveguide. So the second important parameter is the collection efficiency gamma, which is the power detected by the lens or the collection optics over the power in this mode. So in this picture, the single photon source efficiency is simply given as the product of beta and gamma. And how can we now control this light emission from our quantum dot? So one way to do it is to introduce a cavity. So in this slide, illustrates an optical cavity, which basically consists of two mirrors, one which has a reflectivity, which is lower than the others, and the photons, they escape through this mirror. So these optical cavities feature resonances corresponding to this standing wave condition, which says that the effective length of the cavity should be an integer number of the wavelength of the light. So these optical cavities only operate at certain wavelengths, or only store modes or store light at certain frequencies or wavelengths. And the figures of merit of these cavities is the quality factor Q, which says something about how long time the photon can stay in a cavity before it escapes through one of the mirrors. And this is, of course, related to the reflectivities of the mirrors. And this also says something about the width of these resonances, as I'll get back to a little bit later. And then the second important parameter of the cavity is its volume. So basically, a simplified way, the extent of this cavity, so which is proportional to this length here. And when we place a two-level system, our emitter, into an optical cavity, then we create a huge modification of the so-called local density of states, which governs light emission in the weak coupling regime of cavity quantum electrodynamics. So in this regime, the spontaneous emission beta factor can be written up in this way, where this is the emission into the cavity and over the total emission rate, which can be described in terms of the so-called Purcell factor, which is proportional to this Q over V ratio. So these two figures of merit that we just saw in the previous slide. So we see from this equation that a large Q over V ratio leads to a large beta, and in turn a large efficiency, and we should thus optimize this ratio to obtain a good efficiency, to make the Q factor large, so good reflectors, and make the mode volume of the cavity very small. So a challenge with this approach is that it requires a spectral and a spatial overlap of the quantum dot with the cavity mode. So the spectral overlap is illustrated here. So the emission wavelengths of the quantum dot should match the resonance line of the cavity, and this is generally done by tuning the emission line of the emitter into the to that of the cavity, using techniques which are now mastered by many groups in the world. And so far I've been talking about efficiency, another very important property of single photon sources is that they should emit indistinguishable photons. And here a fundamental limitation to the indistinguishability is the influence of the solid state environment. So unlike atoms in vacuum or on free space, then quantum dots are embedded in a solid state material, and they interact with quantized lattice vibrations, so phonons in the environment. And this leads to phonon-induced decoherence. So this figure here illustrates the emission spectrum, so the frequencies of the emitted photons. Here we observe the so-called zero phonon line, which corresponds to pure photon emission with recombination from an excited to a ground state. And this constitutes almost 90% of the emission. But we can also have... We also observe this phonon sideband, as we call it, and this corresponds to phonon-assisted emission, where we do not have direct emission of a photon, but we first have emission of a phonon, so a quantized lattice vibration. And then, because we have lost energy to the phonon, there's less energy for the photon, and then these photons emitted in this phonon-assisted emission process have less energy, they have a different wavelength, and they are thus distinguishable from our zero phonon line, and thus cannot be used for quantum information processing. And this slide illustrates state of the art within single photon sources. So the champion device within single photon sources is the so-called micropillar geometry, which I will get back to in the final part of my presentation. Now, the success probability of this multi-photon interference experiment that we do, for example, with the Shor's algorithm, depends on the efficiency times the indistinguishability to the power of the number of photons involved in our experiment. Now, to get an idea of the device requirements, then we can fix an acceptable success probability, for example, 10 to the power of -7, and we can then estimate the number of photons available in an experiment as function of the product of the efficiency and the indistinguishability. So this figure shows the number of photons available in the experiment as function of the product of the efficiency and the indistinguishability. And we observe that if we want to perform experiments with thousands or millions of photons, then we have a long, long way to go. So this is where we are today. So we can perform experiments with perhaps 30 photons or something like that. But if we want to do something really useful, then we have to climb this curve. And this is actually very much what my own research is about. We can now imagine a dream device with 0.99 indistinguishability and efficiency, so a near perfect device. So this, according to this calculation, would allow us to operate with 800 photons, which would bring us deep into the regime of so-called quantum supremacy, where we can do things with our quantum computer, which are completely impossible to carry out using a classical computer. And this brings me to the major design strategies within single photon source engineering. And now things are going to be somewhat technical. So if the family and friends, they decide now to switch to Netflix, then as mentioned, you are completely completely forgiven. Again, should we take some questions if there are any, or we can of course wait until the very end. Do we have something?
So far, no questions, but please feel free to ask if you have any.
Okay, that's hopefully also, there should be also time for questions in the very end. So let's proceed.
Sorry, I have a question here from, but that was in the chat channel, so I didn't saw that. How is the emission from other levels suppressed? I could see from the energy diagram in the of the QD that we have different emission levels.
Yes, that's a good question. Here is illustrated, you could say, an old-fashioned way of exciting quantum dots, where we excite above band, so we generate lots of carriers, lots of electrons, which drop down into the quantum dot, and then because they have emission different recombination energies, then we obtain emission at different colors, as illustrated here, blue, orange, and red. So during a single excitation, then we obtain many photons at different energies or colors. And what we can do here is then to implement a spectral filter. So we filter out everything which is not within a very narrow wavelength range. And in this way, we can separate these various components photons which are emitted at different energies. So this is how this was done in the old days. And in just a while, I will explain the state of the art within excitation, where you actually avoid this technique. So, this is a very good point. Okay, are there other questions?
Not at the moment, no.
Okay, then let's continue with the with this last part before the outlook, where we will become a little bit more technical, and this largely relies on you understanding Maxwell's equation. So this is mainly now for the engineering community and the electrical engineers in particular. And I should say here that my own contribution over the years has been to do the design and numerical simulations of the devices that I will be showing you in the following, which have then been fabricated with external international partners, especially in Germany and France and in China. So I have done the design and the theory and the numerical simulations, and then the fabrication has taken place abroad. So the champion single photon source with respect to performance is this so-called micropillar, which is illustrated in this scanning electron microscope. So these devices, so they are in nanometer and micrometer with length scales in the order of nanometers and micrometers. So they are so small that you cannot visualize them using regular microscopes, but you have to use electron microscopes to actually observe the devices. So this micro pillar consists of a cavity where we have quantum dots in the center. And then we have two mirrors, so-called distributed Bragg reflectors, DBRs, which are made up of alternating layers of two materials, which provide very efficient reflection of the optical mode profile. So the optical mode profile is illustrated here in black. So you can see there's a maximum at the position of the quantum dots. And then as light penetrates into the mirrors, we have an exponential damping of the modes. And then the top mirror is thinner than the bottom mirror, such that light is predominantly emitted towards the top. So here we implement this Purcell enhancement that we discussed before, such that the quantum dot preferentially emits into this mode here, illustrated using this black line. And then by simply choosing a large diameter of the pillar, then we can obtain a very large transmission to a lens. So this cavity serves to improve the efficiency, but it actually also improves the indistinguishability in the presence of phonon-induced decoherence. So here we consider the two-level system of the quantum dot coupled to the optical cavity via this light-matter interaction constant G, which is inversely proportional to the optical mode volume. So again, a small V is an advantage such that we obtain a large interaction strength. Now, this figure down here shows the black line is the emission spectrum as function of the frequency where we again observe the phonon sideband. So this red curve here is the so-called local density of states, which describes the effect of the resonant cavity on the emission. So at the position of the zero phonon line, we obtain an enhancement of the emission rate. So that's illustrated using this peak. And at other frequencies, then we obtain a suppression of the emission. So in this way, by placing our quantum dot inside an optical cavity, we can enhance the emission into this zero phonon line, which is what we want for indistinguishable photon emission. And we can suppress emission for photons of different energies, which are distinguishable and not useful for quantum information processing. And now getting back to this issue about the excitation, and also to motivate an example of recent work that we did, then this slide illustrates the optical excitation setup. So we have a cryostat with our sample. So these experiments take place at cryogenic temperatures, and we have our device here with a quantum dot illustrated using this triangle. And here we use optical excitation, so a femtosecond titanium sapphire laser, which sends out pulses of light at a frequency corresponding to this red line here. And this is resonant excitation, and this is state of the art within single photon source engineering. So this provides or leads to the best indistinguishability of the emitted photons because you avoid some unwanted processes, which leads to timing jitter and poor indistinguishability. So here the emission energy, so the frequency of the so the color, if you will, of the laser light is here red, and it's the same color as that of the emitted photons. So the frequencies of the emitted photons and the laser light is the same. And now you have the practical problem that is, as if there's even a tiny bit of laser light which hits your detection apparatus, then your single photons from your device will completely drown in the laser light. This is like looking at the sun you're looking for the for a single photon, but you're completely blinded by the sun. So the way we get around this is to use polarization filters. So we implement a polarization filter here to ensure that only light which is polarized in a, let's say, a horizontal direction reaches the sample. And then in the detection, we implement another filter, which filters out all H-polarized light coming from the laser. So in this way, we avoid this looking at the sun effect. And then we only measure photons which are polarized in the vertical direction. Now, the problem with that is that even though we are in this way generating a single electron hole pair, as illustrated here, and then we obtain this high indistinguishability because we avoid these unwanted effects, then this emitted photon is unpolarized, meaning that there's a 50% probability that it will be emitted in the H polarization and a 50% probability that it will be emitted in the V polarization. And we will only detect the photons emitted with in V polarization. So the advantage of this scheme is that it potentially allows for very high indistinguishability, this resonant excitation scheme. However, it only allows you to detect half of the photons that you have emitted. So the maximum possible achievable efficiency is 50%. So one way to get around this is to introduce a so-called an elliptical cross-section of the micropillar, which is illustrated here. So very briefly, when you introduce an elliptical cross-section, then you spectrally separate the two otherwise orthogonally or degenerate orthogonally polarized modes in the circular or rotational symmetric micropillar. So this is illustrated here. And by aligning our quantum emitter to one of the two polarization modes, for example, this H polarization, then the quantum emitter will preferentially emit photons into this H polarized mode. And then we say that we have established polarization control because almost all of the photons will be emitted into this polarization. So in this work, we have demonstrated a degree of polarization of 0.92. And the final efficiency was of polarized photons was 0.6, thus overcoming this 50% barrier in the resonant excitation that we just saw. And this presently represents the world record in efficiency from single photon sources. So this was the so-called micropillar concept, but another concept, another antenna concept that I've been working with for some time now is this so-called photonic nanowire single photon source, which is illustrated in this slide. So this is a different concept. There's no cavity here. So the nanowire is simply a gallium arsenide cylinder sitting on a substrate. So single photons are again emitted by a quantum dot. And as I'll explain in the following, they are preferentially coupled to the fundamental mode of this nanowire. So due to the symmetry of the system, half of the emitted photons are emitted towards the substrate. So we need to implement a bottom mirror to reflect this light back towards the top. And then we need to implement a conical tapering strategy, as I'll explain in the following. So first, to understand, so here we don't have optical cavities. So how can we ensure that most of the light is emitted into the nanowire? So here we rely on a suppression of this spontaneous emission, so a light emission into radiation modes, so into background modes. And to understand this, we can consider the illumination of a nanowire illustrated using this white circle using a plane wave, where we assume that the radius of the nanowire is much smaller than the wavelength such that we are in an electrostatic regime. So this figure here shows the electric field strength as function of the position, and we observe that outside the nanowire, then we have some enhancement and some suppression of the electric field profile. But inside the nanowire, we have a very strong suppression of the electrical field. And in this electrostatic limit, we can calculate that the spontaneous emission rate is reduced by this fraction, which for gallium arsenide is on the order of a factor of 150. And to understand this suppression, then we can consider an optical mode profile so along this in rotational symmetric coordinates, along this radius, so along this half, along this black line here. So the red or the black curve here is the refractive index profile. So 3.5 for gallium arsenide and 1 for air. And this red curve here illustrates the radial part of the electric field profile, where we observe this huge discontinuity of the electric field. And why do we have this discontinuity? Well, it's because of Maxwell's equations. So the boundary conditions between two interfaces requires that the normal component of the displacement field, which is the refractive index squared, so the dielectric constant times the electric field, should be continuous. So this is a boundary condition. So if this quantity here should be continuous and the refractive index squared, so this will be 3.5 squared, so 12. So if this jumps from 12 to 1, and this quantity here should be continuous, well, then the electric field profile has to increase by a factor of 12 at one point. So this leads to this huge discontinuity and thus a huge suppression of the spontaneous emission into radiation modes. So Gerd, how am I doing with respect to time? So I have some 15 slides more. Should I speed up or...
Yeah, I think so. We have 10 minutes left according to the time.
Yes, I'll skip a few slides. Okay,
and so there was a question actually.
Okay, yes.
The method before that, two slides back.
Yes, yes.
With the polarization, polarized the light.
Yes,
the question
yes.
Was what happened if you use different wavelength excitation sources? So instead of polarization, I guess what will happen if you excite with a different wavelength? Can you then separate?
Yeah. So that was I didn't go into detail with that. So of course, what you can do here is to change the frequency of the excitation laser here, such that instead of exciting directly this red photon here, then you could be exciting a P shell or above band with a different color. And this is the general excitation scheme that I was discussing before. The problem with that scheme is that your electron then needs to, well, it will start in the conduction band, for example, or even in the P shell, and then it will have to drop down from the P shell to the S shell. And this takes an amount of time which is unknown and which varies from time to time, and it depends on actually again phonons being present in the environment to absorb the energy which is released when you go from a higher energy level to a lower energy level, and these processes lead to we call it timing jitter. So it's a reduction of the indistinguishability of the emitted photons. So this excitation scheme is great for high efficiency. So you obtain very high efficiency, but the indistinguishability becomes poor. And we want to achieve both very high efficiency and very high indistinguishability at the same time. So for this reason, we are using this resonant excitation scheme because, well, people tend to prioritize indistinguishability higher than efficiency. So this is why this is used. But it's completely correct. If you forgot about indistinguishability and you're only interested in maintaining a high efficiency, then you could simply excite the P shell and then do filtering of the laser line, and then you wouldn't have to implement all of this. That's correct.
Okay, thank you.
Yes. Okay. I'll have to probably have to speed up a little bit. So basically, we're relying on this dielectric screening effect, as we call it, to preferentially emit into the fundamental mode of the nanowire. And perhaps I'll simply show one other issue related to these nanowires, and that is how we control the far field emission pattern. So this is the emission profile for a truncated nanowire where we have done nothing else. And you observe an interference pattern due to unwanted reflection from the nanowire top, plus a strong scattering light to the sides. And we want all of our light to go up to a lens up here, and this is not so good. So our strategy for improving the far field emission pattern is based on an adiabatic expansion of the mode. So here we replace our truncated taper with this needle geometry. So what is happening here is that our optical mode profile is initially reduced. So the width is reduced, that's reduced the width of the nanowire. But then at one point, the nanowire becomes too small to support a guide mode, and then the mode is rapidly expanded. Since the far field emission pattern is related to the Fourier transform of the near field, this leads to a very narrow far field emission pattern, strongly directed towards the collection optics. And I made some calculations of this some 12 years ago, and we figured out that for very small opening angles, then you can obtain excellent transmission to lenses. So my colleague, Julien Cloudon, he actually fabricated one of these nanowires now some 10 years ago. So it's illustrated here. A semi-image is illustrated here of the device with this needle shape that we just saw. The experimentally measured efficiency was 0.72, which was a world record at the time, combined with very clean single photon emission. So this number should be as close as zero, as close to zero as possible. And this led to this cover page of Nature Photonics, which we, of course, were very proud of at the time. A similar device where we're not using a needle, but instead a trumpet, which is simpler to fabricate, is illustrated here. We call this the trumpet nanowire single photon source. So here the field is again expanded, not using a needle, but using this trumpet geometry. So here the efficiency was a little bit larger. The G2 was a bit worse, probably because we had more than one quantum dot inside this trumpet, such that more than one photon could be emitted. Yes, and I'm running out of time here, so I have a few final slides. Gert, is that
Nils, okay? There was a question, if I can interrupt.
Yes, sure, yes.
I read, do the Q factor experimentally lost after integrating the quantum dots to the cavity? If so, how much is the minimum requirement for the Q factor to remain enhanced or enhance the optical output of and maintain the efficiency of the SPS? Thank you.
Yes. So where was that? Yeah, so this micro pillar here, it relies on this Purcell enhancement, which is basically this Q over V ratio that we saw here. And so as mentioned, the micro pillars are the champions right now in single photon sources, and the best designs operate at Q factors of around 5 to 10,000. I believe in this paper on the elliptical micro pillars, the Q factor was around 6,000, and this corresponds to a line width of little less than half a nanometer. And the Purcell factor, so this Q over V ratio here, was around 15 in that particular work. And this is something we would in principle like to optimize towards unity. I didn't have time to discuss this, but actually what happens when you increase this Q factor and this Q over V factor, then at some point you enter into what we call the strong coupling regime in cavity quantum electrodynamics, which is very bad for the indistinguishability of the emitted photons. So we should not play around with too high Q factors, but the Q factors we're working with right now is around 5,000. did that answer the question?
Please reply, the one who asked the question. Is that okay?
Yeah, so I've almost finished. So perhaps I'll take the few last slides and then we can take some time for questions.
But I have a positive answer back. Yes,
good. Okay, good. Answered.
Yes, thank you.
Okay, yes. So to summarize this work, so then what I've been doing for the past 10-15 years or so is to analyze and optimize these various single photon source designs based on these nanowires that we just saw and on these micropillars that I discussed earlier on. And a very interesting design that has emerged recently is this bullseye cavity that I didn't have time to discuss, but which is based on similar effects as actually both the micropillars and these nanowires. So there are some SEM images here of fabricated devices. These have not been fabricated at DTU, but with international partners. And in several cases, this have led to world records in performance and cover stories of these various journals. And so where are we going now? Yeah, so my work is very much targeted on optimizing these efficiencies and indistinguishabilities such that we can work with a lot of qubits, not just 10 or 50 or 100, but thousands or millions, such that we can build a real practical quantum computer which can actually do something useful. And the ERC recently granted me money to work on a new design that we're exploring. So this so-called photonic hourglass, which is illustrated here, which you can see is a kind of a hybrid design between this micropillar and the photonic nanowires that we saw before, implementing also these elliptical cross sections that we saw before. And a SEM image of an initial edge test is shown here. So we will now in the coming years try to investigate if this design is better and can achieve hopefully 0.99 efficiency and indistinguishability. Yeah, I'll skip this. And then mentioned another collaboration project, another EU project that we are involved in at DTU. So this is a huge network project, a so-called Marie Curie ITN project with 15 PhD students distributed over six countries. So we have some 23 partners in total. And one of the objectives of this project is to make single photon sources, not with vertical emission, so into an optical fiber, but where the light is emitted into on-chip waveguides. And here the ambition is to create an optical chip where both the emission and the manipulation and the detection of the single photons is performed on a single chip. And we're very excited about this activity. Yeah, constructing an efficient source of indistinguishable photons is certainly not the only challenge within optical quantum computing. However, it's certainly a very important one. But now let's say that we solve all of these challenges related to the single photon sources and also the other issues such as the detection, and we can construct a full-blown quantum computer, then what can we actually use such a quantum computer for? Yeah, so I skipped the slides, but I argued earlier on that we could use this Shor's algorithm to efficiently factorize very large numbers, which can actually be used to crack cryptography, classical cryptography, as we know it today. And you can perhaps imagine that when this algorithm was suggested in the 90s, then various national security agencies suddenly became very interested in quantum information technology and poured a huge amount of money into the field. However, this is actually not so interesting for me personally. I think a more interesting application of the quantum computer is within medicine and drug design. Here, the pharmaceutical industry is facing the challenge that existing classical computers are unsuitable for solving problems within quantum chemistry and drug design. And here the pharmaceutical industry relies on very expensive, slow trial and error studies. However, due to its very nature, then the quantum computer will be very suitable for solving problems in quantum chemistry. And one could imagine that if we had an operational quantum computer today, then it could be a key tool in developing a vaccine to this coronavirus, which is plaguing the world today. And very finally, I would simply like to acknowledge my international collaboration partners, which have actually, so these are the guys who have actually fabricated these devices. So especially the group of Jean-Michel Girard, but also the group of Sven Höfling, so in Germany. So these guys are from France, these guys are from Germany, and Stefan Eitenstein in Berlin, and then Chaoyang Lu in Shanghai. So this is a more recent collaboration. And then finally, I would like to acknowledge the various funding agencies which has paid for all of these activities in the past years and also in the future. And then I would like to thank you guys and the audience here for your attention. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Nils. Thank you very much. We have so far two questions.
Yes.
One from Jakob Jebsen asks, have you ever thought about working with some of the people from SDU who have also been working with quantum emitters, computers? My old supervisor worked with such a project for a few years.
To my knowledge, then the activities regarding a single photon generation at STU all centered around plasmonics. So please correct me if I'm wrong, but I know that, for example, the research topic of Sergei Bosevolny is centered around plasmonics, where they are also investigating exploiting these huge enhancements that you have when using metals to obtain efficient single photon source generation. So an issue here with the metals, as discussed before, is that you can obtain these huge free field enhancements. I did not talk about them today, but you also have inevitable loss due to the penetration of light into metals. I'm not ruling out that you can invent or come up with a plasmonic antenna design which can compete with some of these micropillars and nanowire designs that we've just been looking at. But so far, it simply hasn't happened, most likely due to the presence of losses in these metal-based designs. So it's another avenue that I'm not personally pursuing. And I would say it still has to, it kind of has to prove itself by now.
Okay. I hope that was answer to the question. Another question was, is how far should or could the photon survive after they have been emitted? And how do you optimize that?
So this is one of the strengths of encoding your quantum bits on photons as opposed to using electrons, for example. So for communication purposes, there's really nothing that can compete with the photon. And this is also why we use optical fibers today for long-range communication. The fibers that we have today have very low loss, around 0.2 dBs per kilometers, which means that if you propagate, 50 kilometers, then you reduce the transmission by a factor of 10. And this, I hope I got the numbers right there. But at least this means that you can really, the photon can really propagate a very long distance before being lost. And this is a strong advantage of using photons. So this is completely compatible with the classical application of long distance communication, that that photons are not really, once you have emitted your photon into your optical fiber, then it's not really lost. This could be a bottleneck at a much later stage, but right now there are much more significant loss mechanisms that we're dealing with.
Okay, so what you're saying is that this is not a practical issue, say, currently?
It could be at a later stage, but right now the problem is with the generation of the single photons. There's also some limitations with regards to the detection. But what is happening in the optical fiber is not a bottleneck at all. So within, actually, so one thing is, if you work with optical fibers, of course, in this project that I briefly presented, we want to do everything on a chip. And here, one of the challenges is to implement low-loss waveguides, so not optical fibers, but waveguides in these materials, where we are placing gallium arsenide waveguides on top of on glass substrates. And here, we have actually a single PhD student devoted to fabricating low-loss waveguides. These will not be as good as optical fibers. This is really the lowest transmission, the transmission challenge with the lowest loss that you can have today. But we hope that we can get the losses down such that that we can still fabricate useful devices. Of course, here, when you create such a chip, you do not have to propagate the photons over long distances. We're not talking kilometers. So this chip is on the order of millimeters or maybe a centimeter. So here we can accept higher losses.
Okay. Regarding that, I have actually a question for myself here.
Yes.
I saw when you have fabricated these pillows that there was, even though they were quite small, there was also quite a lot of them on a single wafer, or the density was rather high. How do you make sure when you activate these or excite these that you actually not get from say 100 different of these, because that would also be give a quite noisy signal.
Sure. So if you were to excite these trumpets here with an unfocused laser beam, which was basically hitting all of these trumpets, then yes, then you would be generating a lot of photons at the same time from each of these trumpets. So the reason why there was made this forest of devices here is that in this particular fabrication process, we did not have control of the positions of the quantum dots. So they were randomly distributed. So what we did was to make a lot of devices, and then we were hoping that there would be a quantum dot inside some of these trumpets. And actually, my collaborators, they have gotten so tired of looking at one device and then looking at the next one, looking at the third one and looking at the fourth one, and looking and going through hundreds of devices before they find one with a quantum dot, that what they did was actually to increase the density of quantum dots such that you really had a lot of quantum dots, a high quantum dot density. And this means that they do not have to look at many devices before they find one with which emits light. But the backside of this was that the champion device actually contained more than one quantum dot. And then you emit more than one photon, and this gives this high G2 value, which means that the purity is not so good in this particular sample. And this I did not have so much time to talk about, but this means that you have to emit or implement some kind of control, spatial control of the positions of the quantum dots. So we have some kind of strategy for spatial control.
Okay. Yes, I don't know if we are thinking the time is running out. We are almost 15 minutes over, but are there some questions still in the audience? If not so, I think we should conclude this afternoon talks from you, Nils. Thank you very much. If this was were ordinary physical meeting in Ida, then I would handed you some bottle of wines. But I think we have to ask the post man to handle that to you. So on behalf of the audience here and Ida, I thank you very much from giving this talk. And we are looking really forward to see what you're working with in the future. Maybe at a later time you can come back and update us on the achievements.
Yes, certainly. That would be my pleasure. And I would also like to again thank Gerd and Ida for inviting me, and then everyone in the audience for participating here tonight. Yeah, thank you all.
Okay. Yeah, but that concluded. Thank you very much, everybody. And good night.
Good night. Bye bye.